Don't you hate it when you turn your car on and the dreaded check engine soon, or the check engine light pops on, right? Well, a lot of times this thing pops on for really easy fixes, things that you don't really have to require. You don't have to take it to the mechanic. You can do a lot of this stuff yourself. Sometimes it just comes from a loose wire or a loose hose or something along those lines. And it can be pretty easy to identify if we let the computer kind of do some of the work for us to help us identify the problem. So what we're going to do is I'm going to plug my OBD2 reader into the truck here, and we're going to find out exactly what code this is. What exactly is my truck trying to tell me? And pretty much every vehicle nowadays, I would say past the 90s sometime, they started doing OBD2 codes. Now, before that, there were OBD codes, but this is two, and it's pretty much a universal, it's a universal thing. So what we're going to do, and almost always, you're going to find it right down here somewhere, okay, underneath the dash. So you can come in and say, oh, well, that's not it. Okay, where is it? And we keep moving, and there it is. Sometimes these guys are got a little cover or something on them, but you're always going to find it pretty much right in this area, somewhere underneath the driver's side. And what we're going to do is we're just going to plug our computer into that and check our codes and see what we're getting. Now, everybody's OBD2 reader, this one is one and two, is going to be a little different. This one's kind of fancy compared to the majority of them that are out there, but for the most part, they all work the same. This one just gives me more information about stuff, and it can do real-time checking of things. So I can turn the vehicle on and run it, and it's going to actually tell me what all the sensors are throwing. But you see right here is the connector for it, and we're going to come down here. We're going to plug this bastard in, just like that. And now we can go ahead and watch this, and it's getting the signal already. It's probably not going to pick up too much unless I put the key in. Okay, so we're going to put the key in. You don't usually start it. You just put it where there's juice going to it. And then from here, I'm going to go vehicle diagnostic. Okay, so we're going to hit enter. These are some of the vehicles that I have. But if I go manual on this, and then I hit enter for US, it's going to say year. So this is 2003. This is a truck. And this is a Ford. And this is an F-150. Oops. This is asking me what size is in it, what size engine. Now, you might not know this, okay? And a lot of times, if you look on the inside of your door, here, or down here, and I'm going to stop at a certain distance, right about here, because the rest shows my VIN number and all this other stuff that identifies the vehicle. I don't need you guys knowing that. There's going to be all sorts of information down here. And beneath what you're reading right there, there's even more. It tells you all sorts of stuff about tire size, you name it. And this is usually found on almost every door. But I'm going to find the information I'm looking for, I think, in the under the hood. A lot of times when you pop open the hood right here on the area where the radiator is, you're going to find some stuff. Sometimes it's up on top of the hood here, sometimes it's on the side. But what we're going to do is we're going to kind of move this stuff over. And this is going to give us all sorts of information. Right here it talks about the OBD code reader, is what we're looking for. This says 5.04 liter group. It tells about the EVAP system, which is about like emissions and stuff. But according to this, this is basically saying we have a 5.4. Now the L, the M, and the Z, I don't completely know what that means. That has something to do with the type of engine and manufacturer and all this other stuff and what vehicle it is. I'm sure it's a special thing.
I have no idea. I'm going to go with the safe number, just basically saying it's 5.4. And we have, this is the information, this is a garage full, blah, 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 blah. That's because I've already done some of this stuff. Diagnostic codes. Okay, so right here, we're going to read codes for this. Bank 1, System 2, lien. Now, yours might end up saying P0 with this three-digit number. And if you don't know what it is, it's going to end up telling you it's 171. So if you don't know what that is, you type that into Google, P0171 OBD2 code. It's going to tell you what it is for your particular vehicle. In this case, it's saying Bank 1, System 2, lien. Okay? This particular one basically tells you it's going to cost like $10 to fix it. Okay? And now this is also saying P0174, the system is too lean. Okay? Now, chances are, when you have an engine that basically is saying that it's too lean, there's an air-fuel ratio. It's called the air-fuel mixture. And you have to have a certain amount of air to a certain amount of gas. And the sensors are going to be reading this ratio. And if it picks up that there's too much air, you're going to get a code like this. It's going to say that, hey, it's too lean. You're not getting enough fuel. I'm getting in both banks, right? Which tells me that it's probably not just like one sensor. It's probably just not like just one little thing. There's probably a loose hose somewhere. A vacuum leak can cause this, which is generally what it is. Sometimes it's a sensor. But generally, this is a vacuum leak. And it's in both systems. So what we have to do is we have to see if we can find a vacuum leak. Ah, the notorious vacuum leak. Okay, what is a vacuum leak? Well, a vacuum leak is basically, if you look at your engine, you're going to see all sorts of hoses. You're going to see some hoses like this. You're going to see some hoses like this. You're going to see big hoses like that. You're going to be seeing hoses like this. You're going to be seeing all sorts of little hoses. You might even see little hoses like this, okay? And all of these hoses are delivering either air, like a vacuum, positive airflow, or it's going to be providing some type of flow of liquid, like water, for cooling and things like that. Or it could be fuel, okay? So a lot of times what will happen is these hoses will become old. And when they get old, they become brittle and they start cracking. And then you can start having what's known as a vacuum leak. Now, in this case, what I'm doing is I'm pushing in all the areas that I see that there is a line. And I'm trying to make sure that there's none of these that are loose. And then I'm also going to be going around the outside of these and feeling for deteriorated rubber. This would also be considered something that you need to take a look at, right? For the vacuum leak. You need to make sure that we've got a good seal on all these. So I'm gonna go through and I'm gonna look at every single one of these hoses and I'm gonna see if I can find one that is disconnected or one that is, that's electrical, I think. I'm going to look to see if I can find any that have been disconnected or any that are deteriorating and cracking, which is usually a big one, deterioration and cracks. Another thing that you should look for is when you look at your intake, they have what's known as an air, a mass airflow sensor, an MAF. And then what happens is these, a lot of times, will end up going bad, they get dirty, and then it gives you false readings. So, you can spray those with a MAF sensor cleaner, or you can just end up getting a new one. But I'm going to go through and I'm going to check all of these, and if I don't see anything, I'm going to go ahead and pop this off and see if I need to clean some stuff out in there. So on this particular vehicle, well, there's a couple of sensors. We got this one right here, which is in this section. We also have one that's inside here. And then this is the mass airflow sensor cleaner. And I'm just gonna drench the shit out of that and try to clean that up. And I'm gonna do the same thing here. This stuff is not the same thing as carburetor cleaner. So
don't think that they're you can substitute. You can't. Sometimes you can, but usually it's better to use this stuff. This cleans a lot better, and it doesn't leave the residue. So, and I've taken this off because I wanted to see underneath this boot, which some vehicles it's notorious. Sometimes underneath these boots it cracks, and you won't see it and you won't feel it until you take it off and you look underneath here. And then when that boot cracks, it allows all this extra air to go in. And when it does, you get a lean reading. Also underneath here can crack. Okay, same thing with these boots. Also, doesn't hurt to kind of get inside here and look to see if any of these are cracked. This right here, you can see where it's deteriorating. You see how that's kind of like falling apart? And that's no bueno. So that needs to be replaced. I think I have some hose. I have to check my toolbox, but that needs to be replaced, because this something as simple as that could be causing this. While I've got this taken apart, I'm going to go ahead and use this opportunity to clean some other stuff with this carb cleaner. We're going to use this carb cleaner in a little bit. This just right here will help clean up any gunk or anything that might prevent this from opening. It feels okay. Back inside here, if I open it up, you're going to see that there's a lot of nasty stuff inside here. Just kind of help clean this stuff out. Now, because I just sprayed a bunch of stuff inside here, it's going to end up making it where the vehicle's probably not going to want to start immediately. Okay, so you have to expect that. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this, push it on, make sure it's exactly where it's supposed to be. Okay, we'll retighten it, because I know that there's no vacuum leaks happening right here. That this is a German virgin, good and tight. It's not going to want to start immediately because of the carb cleaner and the mass airflow sensor cleaner. It might even throw me an error. It's okay, we're going to erase those errors in a little bit. But as soon as I can get this started, we're going to use the carburetor cleaner to see if we can find a vacuum leak. Think that there's a vacuum leak in that area. If there is a vacuum leak, I think it's happening back here. If there is one. I didn't do anything. But right there.
I don't hear it coming, focus on this.
No, it's the engine. You gotta listen to the engine.
The sound's almost kind of like...
Right
like
there.
Stuck. Not stuck, but it sounds like it's trying to like...
I found it. Right here. Right there, it's on the boot. Okay. You hear it?
Sounds like...
And then if you put your finger right there, it gets sucked in.
Okay.
So we found our vacuum leak.
And it's on a fucking rubber boot.
Let me make sure that this one's not broken, but yeah, it's right there. It's right there, man. Okay, so let's see if we can remove this. We might have to remove a little bit more than we really wanted to. But this thing's already starting to fall apart. If I pull on it, this thing's just gonna fall apart. And this happens just because the stuff gets old. And when it gets old, that's pretty much it. Okay, so at Cragen, the local place, O'Reilly Auto Parts, they didn't have the boot that I needed, so I got some of these PVC ones. And I'm just gonna make my own, but this right here is gonna be a little bit too long, so I'm gonna sand a little bit of this off. So we're gonna break that off. If you're having a hard time getting these on, hit it with some WD-40. This stuff is going to end up drying. Wait, it's going to be on this side. Okay, it's going to be something like that. Okay, but one of these we can cap off, or what we can do is we can just melt it and seal it up. So what we'll do is we should be able to warm this up and then just squeeze it shut. That should work. And if it gives me a slight vacuum leak, I'll just put epoxy on that until I can order the right part. But this should work. That should work. So at this point I have to test to see if this is actually going to end up working for the vacuum leak. So I have to start the vehicle up. I don't feel a vacuum leak. No changes. And the thing sounds like it's running better. So that fixed it. So now we have to erase the codes, which you do with the computer.
Where can you get one of these computer things? Or this, like,
all over the place. So that was basically erasing the codes. So now when I go ahead and I turn this thing off and on again, I'm not getting any of my codes anymore. So if I come over here, you'll see that the codes are off. And I will probably drive this for an hour or two or whatever. Of course, I'm not going to do that now. But then it shouldn't come back on. And I should notice a difference in the performance of the truck. Because even a small vacuum leak can affect the way that your truck performs or your car performs, as well as it can even alter your emissions. So if you take it to get smog, sometimes something as simple as a vacuum leak, like what we just saw right there, can make it where it can give it completely different readings. And it can also, by the way, depending on where the vacuum leak is, it can actually even change your acceleration. It can do all sorts of stuff. Vacuum leaks can make it where you have a hard time starting the vehicle. It can make it where sometimes your air conditioner won't even work. Like on my Mercedes, I had a vacuum leak that actually ended up controlling the vents. And so as soon as I ended up starting the vehicle up and the engine kind of came to temperature or whatever, my front vents would stop working. And it was because at first the vacuum
gets from the pump that's underneath the seat, but then after the vehicle warms up and stuff like that, it starts taking it from the intake manifold, but that came loose, and then so my vents would always close and I wouldn't have any AC. So vacuum leaks can cause all sorts of problems in your car, all sorts of problems. And it's pretty easy to find them, because you'll either see that something is disconnected, you'll see the cracks, you'll feel the cracks, or if you can't do anything like that, then what you end up doing is you do the carburetor cleaner. Sometimes you can use things like even propane gas. You just don't light your torch and you put it near things and it can change things, as well as you can use WD-40 sometimes, right? You're just kind of spraying in a certain area, waiting for the engine to sound different. Sometimes the vacuum leak is coming from not a hose, but it might be something like a cracked intake, right? Or it might be something along those lines, which if that's the case, it's not an easy fix. But anyway, hopefully this helps you guys out and helps you a little bit more about using the computers and stuff, because these computers you can get anywhere. You can get them at any hardware, any automotive store. You can order them online. Hell, I think that you could probably get them at places like Walmart too, because they're cheap. They're anywhere from like $15 to $20 all the way up to $300 and $400. The one that I've got here, I think, is about $400, like $380 or something. But this one gives me all sorts of different readings and stuff, and it can tell me during the time that it's running, it can actually, it takes live measurements and it tells me what's going on, so I can help pinpoint the problem. Anyway, guys, that's that. So, till next time, talk to you later.